Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Triple N Media Cardiology Landmark Trials. I am Dr. Nik Nikam from Houston, Texas, and in this presentation, we are going to be talking about Stopdapt 2, dual antiplatelet agent study in patients undergoing percutaneous coronary intervention. This study was reported by Hiratoshi Watanabe from Japan. They posed a question. In patients undergoing percutaneous coronary intervention, is 1 month of dual antiplatelet therapy followed by clopidogrel monotherapy non-inferior to 12 months of dual antiplatelet with aspirin and clopidogrel as far as adverse cardiovascular and bleeding events are concerned? Let us see if we can find an answer to this question. Coronary interventions has been going on for several decades now, and we still have concerns about using dual antiplatelet agents. There are so many questions which are unanswered, and to that we can add this one more question as whether a single antiplatelet agent would be alone sufficient enough for patients undergoing PCI with drug-eluting stents. What is the ideal duration of dual antiplatelet agents following coronary intervention? 6 months, 12 months, indefinite? When the first generation of drug-eluting stents came into the market, there were concerns about these patients having the so-called late thrombosis. So even though the recommendations were for 12 months period, still some physicians, based on the risk factors, would advise their patients to continue on antiplatelet agents without a definite indication as to how long they need to be continuing. What about the dual antiplatelet agents for a metal stent? It's got to be a metal. I don't know how it became mental here. Metal stent. An interesting thing that I observed when I was doing cardiology consultation rotation, and every time we sent a patient for a cardiac catheterization, the first question they asked us is this patient has any surgery or procedure coming up in the next 3, 6 or 12 months? It should dawn on every practicing cardiologist that when we take a patient to the cardiac catheterization lab, the most important question we want to keep in mind is this patient a candidate for dual antiplatelet agents for whatever the length of time that we think is appropriate? Then we have a question of using the right combination of antiplatelet agents and antithrombin agents when you are dealing with patients with atrial fibrillation or valvular heart disease. What causes late stent thrombosis? And is it as common as it used to be with the second generation drug-eluting stents? What about the role of multiple risk factors like kidney problems, strokes, diabetes? Does that add an additional risk so that these patients may need a different regimen compared to those without those additional risk factors? And what are the bleeding differences among different P2Y12 inhibitors, agents? Would a shorter duration of DAPT reduce bleeding complications? Let us see if we can find at least answer to one question, and that is, can a P2Y12 agent after 1 month following PCI provide the same benefit as a dual antiplatelet agent without the added risk of bleeding or thrombosis? This was a multi-center prospective open-labeled randomized trial looking at 12 months of dual antiplatelet agents with clopidogrel plus aspirin or prasugrel plus aspirin after cobalt chromium everolimus eluting stents versus antiplatelet agent P2Y12 alone after 30 days for a period of 1 year. So the study included 3,045 patients. The duration of the study was 1 year. The mean age was 68 years. And look at this, 19% of these patients had STEMI. It would be quite daring to put these patients on a single antiplatelet agent following a STEMI PCI. And 35% of these patients had previous PCI, which further increases their risk of stent thrombosis. This study population had a PCI with the exclusive use of Science series stent. There were no major complications during the procedure. There was no planned staged PCI in these patients. If they had staged PCI, they would be included in the study after the staged PCI was completed. And patient could take dual antiplatelet agents with aspirin and P2 Y12 inhibitors. The exclusion criteria is those who are in need for anticoagulation, like patients with atrial fibrillation or valvular heart disease or deep venous thrombosis, or a patient has a history of intracranial bleeding. Here are some of the demographics of these patients. Couple of things I want you to keep in mind, which I already stressed. One is 19% of these patients had STEMI, and they were enrolled in a single antiplatelet agent study in this particular series. And 14 patients had MI, and 35% had previous PCIs. So let's keep those numbers in mind. Anyway, the primary endpoint was a composite cardiovascular death, myocardial infarction, or stroke. They also looked at TIMI major and minor bleeding. The secondary endpoint was cardiovascular deaths, MI, or definite ST changes, or stroke. The study design was they screened 6,000 plus patients, and 3,045 of them were assigned to the study group. And if you look at the study group, was divided into two different batches. The first one received 1 month of dual antiplatelet. And after the first month, they received only P2 Y12 inhibitor without the continuation of aspirin. They were followed for a year. The second group, both the aspirin and the antiplatelet agents were continued for the entire duration of the study. And this is a different way to look at the study protocol. There we had a diagram, and here we have a linear time relationship chart. So whichever you like, you can look at that. And let's go on to the results. The primary endpoints after 1 year. All these patients received P2 Y12 inhibitor for 12 months. In the 1 month group, aspirin was maintained for only 1 month. In the 12 month group, the aspirin was continued for the entire duration of the study. Now, if you look at the primary endpoint and major bleeding, the incidence was 2.36% in the 1 month group and 3.7% in the 12-month dual antiplatelet group. Actually, this has to come here. So the hazard ratio was 0.64 with a p-value of 0.001. And similarly, the secondary endpoints were 1.96% in the 1 month group, which received only P2 Y12 for the remaining 11 months, compared to 2.51 with a hazard ratio of 0.79 and a p-value of 0.05. Major secondary bleeding was also significantly lower in the group that received only P2 Y12 inhibitor after the first month of dual antiplatelet therapy. Now, here are the graphs to emphasize the points which I already mentioned. In the patients group who received only 1 month of dual antiplatelet agent and then P2 Y12 inhibitor for the remaining 11 months, the incidence was 2.36%, whereas in the dual antiplatelet group, it was 3.70%, favoring the P2 Y12 inhibitor as a single agent for patients following coronary intervention after 1 month of dual antiplatelet therapy. Similarly, the TIMI major minor bleeding was also significantly lower in the single antiplatelet agent group compared to the dual antiplatelet group. If you look at clinical outcomes at 1 year, there was no significant difference in death, myocardial infarction, or definite ST changes. But as far as stroke and TIMI major minor bleeding and BARC 3 or 5 bleeding, all of them showed improvement with single P2Y12 inhibitor for whole year with just aspirin added in the first 30 days. If you look at all the way across the board, based on age, acute coronary syndrome, STEMI, yes or no, severe CKD, yes or no, diabetes present or not, all the stent length and number of vessels stented, all of them, they had a favorable result with 1 month of dual antiplatelet agent and the remaining time with just single P2Y12 inhibitor. So this is a very, very significant shift in the paradigm of treating patients with drug-eluting stents in a variety of situations where they can be safely managed with 1 month of dual antiplatelet therapy and the remaining time with a single P2Y12 inhibitor. When we are using a single antiplatelet agent, thrombosis and stroke becomes an important question, and here is the answer. Paris thrombotic risk score was lower in the 1 month dual antiplatelet regimen. Similarly, the Credo-Cayodo thrombotic risk score was also favoring a single antiplatelet agent after the first month of dual antiplatelet therapy. So this is a clearly distinct approach which favors a single antiplatelet agent in this study population compared to dual antiplatelet agents in terms of bleeding risk and also in terms of thrombotic risk. And if you look at the major secondary ischemic endpoints, there was no significant difference in the two groups. So that means by using a single antiplatelet agent, namely a P2Y12 inhibitor, there was no increased risk of thrombosis or ischemic stroke in the study population. There are limitations to this study. There's no consensus as to how to define the endpoints as far as antiplatelet regimens are concerned. Open label design has its own inherent limitations. There were limited enrollments of high ischemic risk patients, lower ischemic risk of Japanese versus the United States and European coronary artery patients. And of course, in Japan, they didn't have the ticagrelor or pasagrel readily available in the standard doses. And there was no assessment using aspirin alone as a monotherapy. That would be something you would not imagine in this day and age of drug-eluting stents. In conclusion, 1 month of dual antiplatelet agents followed by clopidogrel monotherapy provided a net clinical benefit for ischemic and bleeding events over a 12-month dual antiplatelet therapy with aspirin and clopidogrel after cobalt chromium everolimus eluting stent implantation. The benefit was driven by significant reduction in bleeding events without an increase in ischemic events. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching this presentation, and please do visit our other cardiology landmark trials presented on our YouTube channel. I am Dr. Nik Nikam, and please do subscribe to our YouTube channel. We will see you next time.